Except the crazy thing was, he'd never given those orders. Somehow, they'd simply evolved in the students' imaginations. And once there, they automatically assumed he'd given them. It was as if the wave had taken on a life of its own. And now he and his students were literally riding it.
I'm Lotte.
And I'm Sanne.
And this is Navigating Life.
Or at least trying to.
We're two students, but more importantly, we're two friends.
We're currently studying crisis and security management at Leiden University.
Very fitting, I would say, during a pandemic.
Yes. We also have a background in public administration, which means we've learned about politics, globalization, economics, sociology, and more.
We love to discuss these topics, both in university and in our private lives, and we also love reading books.
Due to the lockdown, we've been spending a lot of time at home, and we started reading a lot more.
And we started exchanging our books, and we realized we love discussing them together.
We figured, why not record our conversations about these books, how they relate to our current society.
And how these books help us navigate life?
Ooh, good segue. More often, it might be nice to listen back to them in 10 to 20 years.
So, what are we going to discuss today?
So today we're going to talk about The Wave by Todd Strasser. It's a novel that he has written while he spent days working as the owner of a fortune cookie manufacturer of all places. And it's based on a real life experiment performed by high school teacher Ron Jones in 1967. And throughout the 1970s, Jones' experiment was cited in a lot of studies, academic papers, and it was widely known. The Wave has become an international bestseller. It won numerous awards, such as the Book Award for Children's Young Adult Literature. And it is frequently assigned in classrooms in the United States and Europe, and is especially popular in German schools, where teachers use it to teach young readers about fascism. The novel has been adapted to a television special, a feature film in the US, and it has been adapted for the screen and the theater abroad. What did you think about the book, actually, to start with?
What did I think about the book? Well, I saw the movie first, the film. It was shown to me in high school during my final year. So that was is now been 5 years, four or five years.
Ago.
It feels like a long time. So I saw it first, and I think also for me, I think it's the quote that you just mentioned, like, "Oh, I would never do such a thing." That was also my first reaction when I saw these students doing this experiment. I was like, "Oh, if my teacher would ask this for me, I'd be like, what are you doing? I'm not participating." But that's so that was also my first reaction. But then about the book itself, I think it's interesting. I think the book itself was fine. I mean it was okay to read. It's also because I already saw the film, so maybe that helped.
Well, I mean,
maybe while reading it.
Yeah, I think I had the same thing. So while reading the book, it was fine. It was the topic was really interesting.
The topic is interesting.
The experiment,
yeah.
Reading about an experiment such as this is very interesting. I'm thinking, what would I do? But the book itself wasn't. It wasn't when I read it that I was like, oh, that was amazing.
Amazing book. I think I was more interested in the topic as well. An interest in history in general, especially, you know, the Second World War and
extremely interesting time period.
Yeah, very interesting, very complex, I would say.
It's also very easy read, by the way, the book.
The book is easy to read, definitely. So I think that all of that combined, so the experiment that the teacher performed, that was, of course, written about in the book, the time,
yeah.
Which was, it wasn't, of course, during World War II, but it was based on basically a clip that was shown about Nazis to the students,
yeah, exactly.
Which is what he based the experiment on. I think all of that combined made it interesting. And I saw the movie 5 years ago, and then I read the book again recently, also in preparation for this podcast. And now I feel like I have more understanding about society due to my studies that I've done, which makes the message of the book even more interesting. I feel like I understand the experiment and sort of the purpose of the book more now than I did 5 years ago.
That is interesting.
Yeah, I feel like due to, my studies, but also just experience that you get.
So it might be nice to talk a little bit about what the experiment actually entailed, what was happening. Can you talk to me a little bit about that?
Yeah, so the experiment was started by Mr. Jones, a teacher. He was 25, very charismatic, and I would say, popular among his students.
Yeah, cool teacher.
Cool teacher. And they sort of looked up to him. Like, I can imagine if you have a young teacher, often that works a bit better. I don't know. There's a bit more of a connection, I would say.
Yeah, you'd rather do something that teacher would say than something someone you didn't like.
Yeah, but that's my personal experience, but still. So I can imagine that a young charismatic teacher, you know, starts an experiment and he tells his students to start behaving in a certain way. You had to stand up if you wanted to say something. The students had different symbols, which were now sort of highlighted what their group was like.
Yeah, if they saw another member, they had to do a certain salute.
Yeah, so he created, through the experiment, almost sort of, he created a group within his classroom.
And I think didn't he want to first only do it for like a day?
Yeah.
And then the next day he came back to school, and when he entered the classroom, all his students were sitting like in this formation, like very, very upright. They had all their stuff already ready. And when he entered the room, they all said in unison, "Well, good morning, Mr. Jones." And he was thinking, "Oh gosh, well, let's continue the experiment." And then I think it just went from there, where I think even if another member didn't salute you when they saw you, you could report them. And if you were reported, you were banished, you were outcast to the library. And if you didn't follow the rules, you could get an F. If you didn't want to participate, you would get an F.
Yeah.
And it's like the snowball effect, where it's just getting bigger and bigger, and people wanted to join because, you know, they didn't want to be outcast. And students were just, I think the trust was gone. There was a lot of fear because anybody could rat you out if you didn't follow the rules.
Yeah, definitely. And I think the purpose of the experiment for him was, of course, sort of to prove that student wrong, I would say, where the student said, you know, "I would never do this. I would never join such a movement." In this case, the student talked about the Nazis. And of course, let's not make too much comparisons to that time, because of course that's very sensitive, and it shouldn't be compared. But then I guess the experiment showed how easily students can join a group, because everyone is doing it. And moreover, if you didn't join the group, it would, you know, not benefit you would not be benefited, no, you would be punished.
Exactly.
For not joining the group. And I think it shows how easily we can lose ourselves in identifying with a group, and sometimes seeing the advantages of being in such a group, thinking those are more important than maybe your own values, for example. I think it that's ultimately what the experiment showed. Which I think was never the plan, as you mentioned. It was supposed to be a day, maybe two, and that was it. And ultimately it went on and on until,
it was out of control.
It was out of control.
Yeah, I think even he himself said that at some point, you know, for a long time he was thinking, "Well, I am the leader, so I am the one in control." But at some point he realized that it went beyond him.
Yeah.
But yeah, I agree with what you're saying. I think students joined the movement, one, because they wanted to be heard and seen by someone. And in this case, it was their teacher, who gave them order and leadership that they actually really liked, because I think in a world, especially for students, there is a lot of uncertainty, a lot of chaos.
Yeah.
And he gave them like this order, but as well as having a collective identity, as well as having people with whom you can do things together. And I think especially in the time we live today, there is a lot of pain, a lot of chaos, a lot of fear. And if there is a group that gives you this sort of order, this calmness, this leadership, this sense of community,
sense of belonging,
I would say. I think it is very easy to lose yourself in that. And I think it's easy to judge and say, "Well, I would have never joined the Nazis, or I would never participated in this experiment." But I don't think it's that easy.
No, I think there should be room for, you know, it should always, there are always two sides, I would say, or there's always room for discussion, I guess. I think especially during these times, you know, we've studied it. But one of the drivers for populism in society right now is that there's a lack of a sense of belonging.
Yeah.
So due to globalization and cosmopolitanism, which means you know, you feel more as a citizen of the world instead of, you know, belonging to a particular country, what we see is that people, a lot of people lose their sense of belonging, and they don't really, they feel like their country, their values, yeah,
they're losing their culture.
Their culture, people, you know, come in and they steal your culture. It's what a lot of people experience.
Yeah, there's a lot of mix and in mix of different cultural characteristics, and yeah, I think it's sort of, I want to say, understandable that people feel lost and people sometimes feel unheard, and they want a place where they feel like one thing that they are heard, that they belong somewhere, and that they know who they are.
Yeah, and that they're not alone in this. I think that's what makes the book so relevant still to this day.
Yeah.
I think it's relevant in different settings, but especially, you know, the political climate is polarizing.
There are a lot of extreme left and extreme rights.
Yeah,
everywhere there's an extreme,
more opinions.
There are more opinions, and society is polarizing increasingly.
Yeah,
and I think it shows because you want to belong somewhere and you want to cling to it. You know, there are so many things going on, and you just wanna feel a bit safe. You want. I think in our studies we learn a lot about security.
Yeah,
and that a big part of security is not the objective sense of the word, but it's feeling secure.
The subjective, indeed. It's all subjective. And I think that's also the case for this book, I would say. It's completely based on subjective feelings. There was no... It was all based on a feeling that, you know, belonging to that group would, I don't know, enhance your position within the school.
Give you a lot of benefits.
Would they give you a lot of benefits? And to some extent, there was an objectiveness in it, because yes, if you wouldn't join the movement, you'd get
an F
instead
for
of an
example,
A. So, of
yeah.
course, that's objective. But a large part of it
yeah.
was purely subjective, and was about the feeling that you were better than someone else.
Yeah, because if you wanted to, well, I think they didn't. You don't realize it when you're in it. But if you wanted to, if everyone of the group decided, okay, we don't want to participate in this, then you'd have sort of the upper hand. But because everybody was afraid of everyone, and you
yeah.
didn't know who was going to turn you in, you didn't know if you could trust. Like, friends suddenly were rivals, and so I think if we look at it, how can we relate to it today? Is indeed, you know, making sure that you don't lose yourself in whatever, I think, yeah, I don't know if you want to say group you belong to, or because that sounds really polarizing, but you know, make sure that you look around you and make sure that, you
there,
know,
make sure there's always room for debate.
Exactly.
Don't just assume something is the way it is because that's how it's supposed to be. I would say the lesson you can learn from this book is, because we assume almost that we would never join in, it also that sort of removes your
critical view.
Yeah,
on
your
it.
Critical view, I would say.
Like asking questions about
asking
it.
Questions and starting that debate. And I think due to the polarization that is happening in society, starting a debate might also be scarier,
yeah.
and might
I think it's very scary because
yeah,
well, one hand, because sometimes it feels like the views are so far apart. You're like, well, why would I bother with discussing it? Or, well, we'll discuss it, but I'm just gonna stick to my views and
yeah.
I'm not gonna change it
because it's the easier way, or it's something
the more secure way.
More secure way,
because it's scary to say sometimes, well, I might be wrong.
That is scary. And I think it's also because you've been conforming to a group for such a long time. And then to say, for example, oh, wait, maybe I don't agree as much
exactly.
as I used to do. Again, that sense of belonging is like, okay, but
yeah.
where do I belong now if I lose my identity to that group?
I think for us especially, we're 21 both.
Yeah.
And we're in that age group or maybe a little bit past it where you're really discovering your own values. And I remember that the way that I grew up and the views of the people around me are now so different from my own.
Yeah.
But they used to be mine or in some way. And I started losing those values, some or part of them, and discovering my own points of view. And I think that process is so good,
yeah.
But it can also be scary because sometimes
lonely.
It's like, and it can be lonely because sometimes like, well, I don't agree with you, but you know, I do love you,
yeah.
You know, but we're so different on this subject, and it can be hard and it can be difficult. But it does show that that's very good to, you know, make sure you question, even if they're your parents, even if they're your best friends, to, you know, it's okay to question.
Yeah, I think it's one of the things also I hope I will never lose, I would say, is the curiosity.
Right.
To always find out more. And I think, you know, belonging or wanting to belong to a group, there's it's human, it makes sense. I think everyone wants to conform to a certain group. They want to belong somewhere because that's what the human instinct is, to to belong somewhere. I think that was also mentioned or and shown in the book and in the film. There was a student, and I cannot recall his name, but he was bullied, and then the experiment started, and all of a sudden there was a group which he belonged to. And it didn't matter that he wore, I don't know, inexpensive clothes, or that his parents were poor, and that was also vice versa, also for the people who were, I don't, let's say, rich or whatever. He belonged to a group, and his status didn't matter anymore, his background. And it gave him a sense of belonging. For once, he wasn't judged based upon, I don't know, his looks. No, he belonged there. And then the experiment stopped, and all of a sudden he was thrown back into this position of being lonely and again being judged upon how you look and I don't know, your background instead of who you are. So I think, and it shows thus how important it is for people to have this belonging to
exactly.
a group.
And I think sometimes it feels mutually exclusive.
Yeah.
Where you think, well, either I belong to a group, we all agree, and therefore I'm also distant from the people who don't agree with me. So sometimes it feels like those things, that it's either belonging to a group and not agreeing with others, or being outcast. But, you know, it would the perfect world would probably be where we can all sort of, we could all celebrate our differences as long as these differences don't exclude people, you know what I mean? So I think that's a good point to take away from the book.
Yeah.
And as well as learning, well, it's learning from history, but also not judging the past in such a way where you're like, well, I am better than that, you know.
Definitely. And it is I think it's one of the most important lessons, and that's also still a point of reflection and point of learning for me. A learning point every day is I also have the tendency to sometimes think about certain groups who think a certain way, to think, how is this even possible? How can you think about such issues in such a way? I don't understand.
Yeah,
I
you
really
make a really
don't.
Good point.
And so it's also, as humans, of course, we're not perfect. So we also have the tendency to assume that what we think is the right way of thinking.
And other people must be wrong then.
Must be wrong. And I think the experiment shows that, but it's also why it's still so applicable today. We all have a tendency to like I said, to follow a group because there's belongingness, and that makes you lose your curiosity, but again, your critical being critical about situations or critical
about
your
the group
things.
Sort of you
and
belong
that means
to.
Being critical indeed the group you belong to, but also to other groups.
Yeah, so you would be critical, you know, towards others, but not towards people you feel like are part of your circle.
And that's so, and that's I think the main takeaway
I think
from
so
this
too.
Book is be critical, and there's nothing wrong with wanting to belong to a group. I mean, again, I also like to belong to a group, I would say, because it gives me an identity. It gives me it's part of my identity as well, because even if it's your political affiliation,
for sure,
then
it's okay to have a sense of belonging, to have that more with certain people,
of course,
but the line should be, there shouldn't be lines to where that ends.
No.
Do you know what I mean? There shouldn't be borders from, okay, so this is where my group stops and your group begins, but it should be less looking at people in glasses, you know, less seeing them, but more seeing them like we are all one people, and we do have differences, and sometimes it's easier to communicate with people who are more on your norms and values. But let's, you know, but let's make sure that we don't alienate from one another.
No.
And that we're not looking at each other in groups, but more so as in all individuals who all are different. And
yeah.
I think that's the most important
part. And ultimately, we all need each other, right?
Yeah.
I think there's, it happens because we all have to live together in every country, you know, all around the world. Ultimately, your neighbors could be someone from a completely different, I don't know, religion or whatever, and you still have to you live next to them, and I think that's
and there's so much beauty in differences,
especially in differences, and I think as long as you can have, you definitely don't have to agree, because that's of course that's, but you know, having a respectful conversation about things, even if you don't understand, even if you don't affiliate with their belief or whatever, be respectful and yeah, I think that's
respect. That's where everything starts.
Yeah, it starts with respect. So, how did the book end?
Well, the book ended when Mr. Jones sort of announced that there was going to be a rally in the school, and I think it was either in the auditorium or someplace, and all the students gathered there, or all the students who actually were allowed to be there because they were part of the wave. And they were there, and Mr. Jones said, well, we are actually part of a nationwide movement, and our real leader or the presidential candidate will be shown on screen. And everybody was super excited. And then they actually showed Hitler and the Nazis on screen. And suddenly, I think the whole room was silent, and I think in shock. That is how Mr. Jones decided to end the experiment. And I remember that scene. I actually was that gave me a little bit of chills, because it was like, what if I was in the auditorium and I just suddenly saw Hitler and I was like, what have I done? So that was sort of this very abrupt ending of the story. But then let me ask a question back. Why do you think people should read this story and read this ending? And what was the main takeaway for you?
The main takeaway for me still is be critical. Be critical about yourself, about your behavior, about the choices you make, the people you follow, the political parties you vote for, or whatever. Be critical and also dare to be curious about life in general, but especially about other groups, and start a debate if you feel like it's necessary, even though it's scary, even though it's something you may not be used to. But it shows how important it is that people remain critical of others, but also of themselves, to avoid waves like this.
And as well, right, to remember to not judge people so easily and to put yourself in their position, right?
Yeah, definitely. And to have empathy as well
for
people, their situations. To end with a quote from Mr. Jones himself, because of course it was an experiment, and when it comes to experiments, oftentimes there's always room for improvement.
Mr.
Jones also recognized that, and this quote, which we're ending the podcast with, summarizes that perfectly.
I realize now that I made a mistake. A history class is not a science lab. You can't experiment with human beings, especially high school students who aren't aware that they're part of an experiment.